Good morning, New Hope Fellowship. Welcome to San Dimas Canyon Park. Praise the Lord. Those that brave to come into the early morning here where we sprang forward in daylight savings time and you're here. There's others that are still sleeping. They're going to miss a blessing. No, they're always blessed because they're in Jesus. Amen. And we're glad to have you join us. You know, we've had up to well over 150 people watch us on live stream every Sunday. It's back east, Massachusetts, other places, Rhode Island. And so welcome, you that are going to join us and you that are joining us now live here in the park. But the Lord is so good. He's good all the time. And as we look to him, he'll help us through every situation we go through. And right now, with the COVID crisis, he's helping us. Sadly, there are loved ones that are not here. And you have friends as well that are still sick, but praise God, we're going to get through this. Amen?
Amen.
I got a shot about a month ago. I'm feeling good. But, you know, that's everybody's choice. But praise God, we are going to get through this. And my grandson last week, he played football at Bonita. It felt normal. We're going to get back to some normal stuff. Aren't you glad?
Amen. Amen.
Would you bow your hearts with me? Let's pray and thank the Lord for his presence in you and here with us in this service. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do. You're good all the time, oh God. You love us so much. You're crazy, God. You're crazy in love with every person and all of creation. Lord, even the trees, one day, they will clap their hands because, Lord, their redemption too draws near when you come back, Lord. But until then, we thank you for the privilege to be in the park or, Lord, churches around the world celebrating you today because of your goodness and grace in their life, giving them life in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Have your way as we worship you and enjoy one another. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone would say,
Amen. 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 God is good. Amen. Amen. My wife wasn't able to make it, but I'm blessed to have my niece and nephew help me sing today. So thank you, Jesus. But Psalms 104, verse 33 says, I will sing to the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. You know what? We need to praise the Lord because we do have our being. We have everything because of him. But there could come a time where we might not be able to be singing praises like this out in public. So, but long as we can, I say we shout to the Lord this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Raise your voice, even if you don't know the song. Lift your hands. It's a sign of a praise to him. Because without him, we have nothing. And we are nothing without him. So I'm encouraging you. We have everything because of him. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. God, we thank you. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one we could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Oh, we live for you.
this morning. We worship you and exalt you, Lord God. We thank you, Father God. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you and exalt you, Lord. We magnify you, Lord.
Thank you, sweet Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I hold, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not captive to the light. I'm not afraid. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every. There's resurrection power that can save. Power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Exalt you, Lord God. Lord, we thank you that our shame is gone because of your love for us, Lord. We thank you. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. the sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy.
Praise you for speaking to our hearts this morning, Lord. Open our ears to hear your voice this morning, Lord God. Lord, we thank you for the understanding that you'd give us through your word this morning, maybe even through a conversation, Lord God. Lord, but most of all, we thank you for the breath of life that you've given us, Lord, to come, Lord, to worship you and exalt your holy name, Lord God. We thank you for your love that's in this place, Lord, in this park, Lord. And Lord, we pray, Lord, that your love will radiate through this whole park and touching those that need a special touch this morning, Lord God. Lord, we bless those that aren't here today, and especially bless those that are here, Lord, that they would not leave this park the same, but they would leave, Lord, with that word of encouragement, that word of hope transformed in their lives, Lord God. Lord, and again, we just give you all the praise and all the glory, and the church says, amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. The Lord is good, isn't he? Yeah. Be worshiping him. Amen. In a park where we're outdoors enjoying his presence and one another. And you that are joining us live stream and later on YouTube, people pick up messages throughout the week, and so we're okay with that. But just get fed in the Lord, read your word daily, and know that, man, he has a special purpose for every one of us, because he cares for us. Amen. And we have one special lady. She's not here. That's Becky Carmichael. We need to keep her in prayer. She had a real big operation. She'll get through this. She's doing well. And we need to remember her in prayer as well. And also, too, after the service, we have a bunch of stuff over here. Please don't go home without loading up. But the beautiful thing about our relationship with the Lord is that it's a personal relationship, but it's also a community relationship. Heaven is going to be full of a lot of people, and God has a purpose for all of us, individually, but also corporately. And God wants us to walk corporately with one another, just as he shows us in our families how important family is. It's just not me, myself, and I. It's always about others. That's why God is an other-centered being. He's always thinking of others, you and me. But a lot of times we get stuck. We get stuck on ourselves, or stuck on what people have done to us. And God really wants us to be free. And how do we get free? We give our care to the Lord and then receive his strength to go through every day. Amen? I mean, could you imagine going through this life without any help at all? People, my friends, we're alive because he loves us. And that's your prize. I mean, you may have a whole lot of stuff in this world, but your life is your very prize. There's places in the Old Testament where things were happening, big consequences and things that God is allowing in his own nation, that special nation, Israel. And they got their eyes off of him. And they were wondering, well, God, why are you doing this? I want my old life back. And finally, he did say to some, he says, yes, protect your life in that one sense and know that your very life is your prize, what you have as a human being. And then not only that, as we sang in this song a few songs back, that one day after 10,000 years and forevermore, we'll be praising this King. So this is a short little journey. But while we're on the journey, it's so important that we stay lighthearted and give the Lord our cares. Nothing's worse when people are overwhelmed with anxiety. The Bible tells us in the Psalms, I believe it's Psalms 91, fret not. And, you know, because it actually says it does harm to you. Either Psalms 91 or Psalms 34. It's in the Psalms. But fretting and worrying doesn't do us any good. So this morning, I just want you to just stay seated. We don't have to hold hands. We normally would in the past, call it the wall out of Ezekiel 22. The Lord looked for somebody. You're that somebody to stand in the gap and give the Lord your care. I mean, yeah, every week you say, well, we do this every week. Well, you know what? Every day we're to get in the gap, give the Lord our cares. Amen? I mean, this isn't a one-time deal. Yeah, a one-time deal when you ask Jesus in, but you're constantly going through changes in ways that, you know, our environment, our health, people around us, and the Lord wants you to be free and trusting him that you're not overwhelmed with anxiety and do foolish stuff. So would you bow your hearts with me? And at the end, we'll just take a moment of silence. Friends, you that are viewing and will view later on, practice this. Cast your care in the Lord because he cares for you. You care for yourself, but the Lord cares even more for you. He died for you, and he wants you to know that he's going to help you through every situation. So Heavenly Father, we come to you. We thank you that, Lord, we are seated with Jesus in heavenly places. In heaven, Lord, spiritually we are the bride of Christ, seated with him. And Lord, we get overwhelmed. Lord, we come out of that bride chamber of life and we get beat up by different things. And Lord, you don't want us, Lord, to be overwhelmed, but to stay in peace and the joy of the Lord and to help others come into that bride chamber and be beautified with your love. And Lord, we know that there's times where we physically are hurting. We pray, Lord, for those who are physically hurting here in the park as well as those that are viewing. Lord, we pray for healing. You said, Lord, we could ask anything in your name, and so we pray for healing. Those that have bodily problems with issues, Lord, you said we could ask anything, so we ask that. Lord, would you heal, touch those lives, those bodies right now, And Lord, where there's relationships, where there's just, they're struggling in marriages, in families, in associations, with, in the workplace. Lord, we just pray. Lord, you want unity. You love unity. There's not going to be any disunity in heaven, and you don't want it in the bride's life with the bridesmaids who've accepted your son. So we pray, Lord, peace. Let there be a peace, a beautiful peace of love and joy, unspeakable and full of your glory. And now, Lord, I also pray for provisions. You're Jehovah Jireh. Lord, when it looks impossible to meet the financial needs or whatever we're going through, Lord, you said you will provide. And so I pray blessings on those avenues. And now, Lord, you know where we're at, each individual, more than we know ourselves. But what we do know and are aware of, we take this moment to cast our care upon you, Jesus. You said, come and take your yoke upon us. And Lord, and to learn of you, for you're meek and lowly in heart. And you said, cast our cares on you. Friends, right now, would you cast your care on the Lord, whatever that is, whatever you just think in your mind, this is really bothering me, Lord, I give it to you. Would you do that right now? Let's take a moment and give the Lord our care. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, your grace, and kindness. That, Lord, you're good to us. And, Lord, we give back to you, Lord, the pressures that we can't take onto you to help us through this day and every day. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone would say, amen.
Amen. God is good. Amen. Just a few announcements this morning. Again, I just want to encourage the women to get involved with the women's devotionals on Monday. Again, there is a number on here, or if you're not sure or if you don't have one, get a hold of Sister Laura or Miss Barbara, and they'll tell you how to get on the women's Monday night devotional, as well as I'm encouraging you guys to get on a Wednesday night. It's the same number that we get on Zoom, and again, I'm just encouraging you, we need to be in prayer. Our nation needs a lot of prayer. You hear all the chaos that's going on the southern part of our nation. We need to pray for our administration. Regardless of how you feel for the man, you pray for Joe Biden. You pray for him. Pray for his administration. The Bible tells us to pray for him. Pray for your governors. Pray for your council members, because their decisions affect where you live and affect your lives. So again, our nation needs a lot of prayer. So remember, even our men and women that are serving our nation, our police officers, again, all our first responders, firefighters, doctors, nurses, medical staff, they all need our prayer, as well as all of us. We have family members that are struggling, going through things, need prayer. So we can't say there's nothing to pray for, right? There's always something to pray for. Pray for our kids to go back to school, that, you know, they'll open up on that as well. And also remember the homeless ministry as well. Pray for Sister Lana. She goes out every other week. And again, if you want to get involved, talk to Sister Lana, how you can get involved. If you don't want to go out, but maybe you want to get involved by donating, you can talk to her about that as well. So again, I just encourage you guys also that Easter's coming up. If you'd like to bring some filled eggs for the Easter egg hunt, or if you have any questions, see Miss Barbara after. So again, we're starting to collect those again for Easter. Am I forgetting anything? Barb? Good? Amen. How many know it's good to give to God? There's one thing that I've learned in life, and that is you can never outgive God. The more you give to God, the more God's going to provide for you. You might say, well, I'm not rich or nothing, but God's providing you a warm house, a roof over your head, food, clothes, clean clothes at that, running water, heat, whatever it may be. He'll provide your needs, not your wants, but your needs. But again, when you give to God, like I tell you, we can see the stock market going this way, and when you invest in the kingdom of God, your stock just keeps going up and up and up. Because you might not reap the benefits right now, but there's going to be a time where you're really going to need God, and God's going to make that miracle come through. God provides for us each and every day, even with just a cup of water. Sometimes things like that we take for granted. And I say that because Sister Laura always asks on Wednesday, anyone have a praise report? And we're all like, but you know what? It's even when someone buys you a soda or a cup of coffee. That's a blessing that we don't think about. We're thinking huge, but it's not. It's those little things that God still shows you. I provide for you, I care for you, and I still love you. So again, we have our box over here for tithes and offering. Even if you want to donate to missions, you can give over here, or you can go to our website at newhopefellowship.org, San Dimas, and follow the link that way. Amen?
We're trying something new here. Test,
can you hear me? Yes, test. We're trying all kinds of new stuff. We're trying to just for the audience and our live stream as well as in the park to try to connect the best that we can. Can you hear me out there? Am I coming through okay? Yes, there it is. That's a little better. But our youth are going to be dismissed for our youth group, as well as our children's ministry. How many have notes for this morning's sermon? How many do not have the notes? Lana will give you those notes. Yes? How many? Everybody have notes? Okay, good. All right. I like to always give the notes because a lot of times you know, after the sermon, it's like, what did he talk about? And you that are viewing live stream, maybe you should write some notes down. So I just want you to know we're going to be covering 2 points. And those points are our faith and fulfilled prophecies centered around Jesus. And we're going to be looking at those verses there. And the second point is this. Our message is justification by faith in Jesus Christ. But we're going to be looking at the book of Acts. We've been studying for several months now, the Holy Spirit and believers. It's a series that we've been looking at. And one of the things that I always like about as a pastor, I mean, some people think, well, it's a pastor's job. It's so important that what you do. I get it. But what's really important, too, is to understand that you are ministers of the Most High as well. And I think every pastor worth their salt, and I really mean this, out of the book of Ephesians, their job is to train up others. Just even come to a service like this, you get trained by saying, I want more of Jesus. I mean, there is always classes to do study on, and that's good too. But the job of every pastor on this planet is to raise up others to do this, the work of the ministry. The work of the ministry is to tell others about Jesus. And that is what the Holy Spirit's job is working through you and I. So I just want to share the title of this sermon. It's the Holy Spirit's ministry of the gospel story. It's the Holy Spirit's ministry of the gospel story. The Holy Spirit has ministry too, but he works through you and me. And so you have in your notes the theme, and let me just open my notes too. But the theme here, as you see, is the Holy Spirit delivered powerful sermons on the acts of God throughout Israel's history. Real quickly, the Holy Spirit has always been working and speaking through Israel, and the acts that you see in the Old Testament, these are testimonies of God's love working through Israel. The Holy Spirit is the actor and director of Jesus Christ's redemptive story in history, culminating in the coming death and resurrection of Jesus. The Holy Spirit is working. He's behind the scene. He's here behind the scenes. Amen? He is. It's without the Holy Spirit. I mean, we have the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But behind the scene, these three that are one, they work together. They don't just say, well, it's your turn, Father. It's your turn, Jesus. When the Holy Spirit works, the Father and the Son are working with them as well, with him as well. But also, too, here's the beautiful part. The Holy Spirit is the representative behind you
to tell the gospel of Jesus Christ to. He's that agent, and he's the one moving through you and I. He's that agent and representative behind you and I as well to tell about the Lord. Isn't that neat? You think, well, I can't do this. I feel alone. You're never alone. We are never alone when we have Jesus. When we ask Jesus in our life, you've come into a kingdom that will have no end, but also a kingdom that will say, I will work with you, I will help you, I will strengthen you. Well, I'm too old for this. I'm too young for this. I don't think that's a proper way to look at this kingdom. God would use, he used a little boy by the name of Samuel. He was 5 years old, and he was in the temple. He was donated to the temple through a woman named Hannah. And God spoke to him, and he said, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel, he said, what is it? He thought it was Eli, his adopted father. And eventually he kept running to Eli, and Eli said, well, I didn't call you, Samuel. Go lay down. And it turns out that eventually Samuel realized that it was God speaking to him, because Eli said, Samuel, when he speaks to you again, say this, Lord, speak to me, your servant listens. A five-year-old. And later on you have older men and women who were in the temple, such as Simeon. And her name was Anna, and they waited on the Lord, and the Lord spoke to them. So there's no specific timing in that sense. When a heart is open and God has purpose for all of us, God's going to use us. I want to also share with you a proposition. A proposition is this. I'm not propositioning you, but I'm telling you it's an if or a then or when and now. The proposition is this. That when a believer sees the greatest need, that people need Jesus as their Lord and Savior, then they too will seek the Lord on how they can share the gospel story to others, knowing the Holy Spirit will help them share the redemptive story to humanity. God wants to use us. He will, when our hearts, when we realize, it's, hey, we have Jesus, I'm going to heaven, God doesn't just say, well, it's all about you, Bob, and that's all there is. No, he's called you into this kingdom to enjoy his presence, but also too, to now what has been freely given to you, you get the privilege, you and I get the privilege to share Jesus with others. Amen? Nothing's more exciting than sharing Jesus with others. Way back when I came into the kingdom, I worked for my dad in the business. I was married early. I was 20 years old with my wife Barbara now, and I was a salesman for my dad. And so business was slow, so I'm going to all these places of employment, such as hospital offices, and see if they needed any printing material. And so I'm knocking on doors, and I go into the office where people are waiting in the waiting room to get to see the doctor. And so I'm trying to sell the product where I had worked. And in the meantime, I knew what Jesus had done for my life. I began to share with this lady and her daughter what Jesus meant to me. I mean, it just started coming out, and she was really interested. And so in the process, she wanted to know more. So she invited me to her home. This where I first talked to this office was over by Queen of the Valley, where these hospital doctor's offices were, and she lived over there near La Puente, Walnut area. And so a couple days later I went by myself because she invited me there, but lo and behold, I didn't know that she had made a dinner and invited other guests just to hear me what Jesus had done for me. She wanted her friends to hear about Jesus and what he meant to me and how I can talk to these people. Now, honestly, I was really nervous because I'm about a year out from knowing the Lord, and I'd read my Bible every day, but there's just things that I didn't know a whole lot about, like a lot of stories in the Old Testament, the things that Jesus had purpose. And so in the process, these people are waiting in this home. The dinner was set. I'm going, my gosh, I'm 21 years old, and I just felt put on the spot. I was nervous, and I shared my story, and she really wanted her daughter to hear the gospel, and I had that privilege. But here's the problem: is that
you know, I didn't know a whole lot of prophecy and stuff of the Bible. And I was caught, in a way, off guard because I wasn't downloaded enough. And in a lot of ways, that can be okay, but in that process, it meant a lot, I think, to the lady if I would have said more. Now, I did the best that I could, but as I look back, I wish I would have really spoken to her more, and the daughter, and all these guests that were there that I didn't even know, never met them before, except the mother and the daughter. But many times, we as believers, we had that sense, I want to evangelize others. Well, it's great. It's a great attitude to have. I want to share Jesus, and we should have that. But it's also important that we read the Word and know what the Word says, and prophecies that we see in the Old Testament that point to Jesus. Amen? And we're going to look a little bit later about, like, Isaiah 53. If you've never read Isaiah chapter 53, it talks about Jesus who would come to the people of Israel, and for not just Israel, but all the people of this world. But there again, we can be a sense we feel there's a lackluster because I'm not able to do this. Now, if you're put in a situation like that, God's still going to use it, using that name, what your testimony. But because I was so young in the Lord, I really kind of froze up. But that opportunities like that don't happen all the time, where they invite you to the house and would you tell me about that? We're going to look at the Apostle Paul. He had that opportunity, and he unlocks the Scriptures because he knew the Scriptures. He's a Messianic Jew. He knew the Lord, and he wanted the people of Israel and the Gentiles that were in that time to know the gospel of Jesus Christ, this love that came from above. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. He came, the Father gave the Son of God, became the Son of Man, that whosoever shall believe in him, they should not perish, but they will have everlasting life. This isn't all that there is, friends. We will have everlasting life to those that love the Lord. So if you have your Bibles, you at home, here in the park, let's turn to Acts chapter 13 and look at Paul's situation, where he gets the invitation and he begins to tell them what the Lord has done for them. That's the connection, what God has done for the Apostle Paul, but also too what he wants to do for every person. So if you look with me, chapter 13, let's look at verse 26, we'll go to 43, and listen to Paul's dissertation. He's talking about the Lord. Could you imagine could you imagine if somebody were to say, if you just listen to this story, if you just listen to this story, you're going to win $5 million. Do you think that you would just start scratching and looking around, looking up in the air, you know, falling asleep? What do you think? I don't think so. And that's how important this message is, because it's not about the wealth of this world. It's the wealth that's in the next one that God says is yours. Amen? It's yours now. And if you take it lightly, friends, maybe you just might miss the boat. The Bible tells us about possibly missing the boat, not the boat, but missing that time when the Lord calls you if you're not ready. That's the Bible talks about. There's 10 virgins, and 5 were ready, and 5 were not. 5 were filled their lamps with oil, which represents the Holy Spirit, to fill their lives so they can go out and be a productive believer. But there's 5 that says, I got time. Friends, COVID has taken a lot of people that weren't ready. And some were ready in that time when their departure came. And the Apostle Paul, like us, we will have that time. You will have that time to tell others about the Lord. So let's look at Acts chapter 13, verse 26 to 43. And Paul actually already had an opening telling them about, before that, with Israel in a synagogue. And now he's talking to them, men and brethren. He's talking to Jews that are in a synagogue. And he says, men and brethren, sons of the family of Abraham, which are Jews, Israelis, and those among you who fear God, Gentiles as well. To you the word of this salvation has been sent, for those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, nor even the voices of the prophets,
which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them in condemning Jesus, condemning him. In other words, there are people that they read the word and they don't understand it. We're going to break that down. That's the problem, is a lot of times people, they think they know all about the Lord, but they don't understand because their heart isn't hungry. You know, God's not going to make you be hungry for him if you don't want to be. I told you in the past, God is pro-choice. You can be an atheist. You can be anything you want. You don't have to believe in God. God made us that way. But the Bible says, he who seeks the Lord will find him, and you'll be enriched in your life. And there are people that, you know, I said when he's pro-choice, God does say, do not murder. I don't get into that. But God gives us that ability. And so even in the scriptures, if your heart's not hungry for the Lord, the scriptures aren't going to make sense. Does that make sense? If you aren't hungry to read something or a letter from somebody and you just rush over it, have you ever just read a letter or somebody gave you a birthday card and you rush through it real quick and the person who gave it to you, well, did you read the card? That's my love letter to you. I've done that before and I've gotten in trouble with Barbara. Oh, okay, I'll read it again. It's the same thing with the Bible. Read it with an open heart. And don't just skim through it, but read it. And Holy Spirit will grab you and hold on to that thought in your mind and in your heart. And you'll say, wow, I saw something I never saw before. Have you ever experienced that before? You've taken the time to listen. And so Paul's saying to them in verse 28, and though they found no cause of death in him, in other words, the time when Jesus was put on trial, they asked Pilate that he should put him to death. Because in their law, they could not crucify Jesus, but they asked Pilate, would you do this? Now, when they had fulfilled that which was written concerning him, they took him down from the tree. That tree is a cross. A lot of people say that tree, well, it wasn't a cross, it was a tree. No, it was a cross. A cross where Jesus was nailed to. And they laid him in a tomb, but God raised him from the dead. He was seen for many days by those who came with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are his witnesses to the people. By the way, in 1 Corinthians 15, the Apostle Paul, some people are saying the resurrection didn't happen. He says, no, it did happen. And he says he was seen by 500 people. In a park like this, they were in an open area in Galilee, 500 people said, Jesus is alive. And when Jesus ascended on high, they're watching him ascend. Jesus ascended on high, and he was seen by many. And we declare to you, Paul says, we declare to you the glad tidings that the promise which was made to the fathers. By the way, friends, this promise was made to Israel first of all. The Messiah would come for them, but they missed him on that first time of his appearance. And they didn't even realize they were crucifying the Lord of glory. But that was God, who's Alpha and Omega. He knew they would do that. That's the weird part. I mean, I know there's so much we don't understand, but when we seek him, he'll give us a little understanding if you're hungry. If you're not, you can go to sleep. You can, you know, just whatever. It doesn't matter. But those who are hungry, they'll be filled. And those who are thirsty will have their hearts quenched. And out of them, because they're hungry, will flow out of them a joy, a living water. It's a spiritual water. They'll overflow. The Bible says they'll be filled with glory with his presence because they're hungry for him. And Paul says, we declare to you, he's talking in the synagogue, you know, these people that he was invited. And Paul's, man, he's cutting loose. And he says, and we declare to you the glad tidings that the promise was made to the fathers. God has fulfilled this for us and their children, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalms. You are my son today. This is this coronation we see in Psalms 2. Today I have begotten you. Begotten him for this very purpose, to come into the world and to give us life. That he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. What is corruption? In other words, when we die, friends, our bodies go into a morphous of death, and it corrupts. It goes back to the earth. When people die, a third of them stay here. Their spirit and soul goes to two places, heaven or hell. He that has a son has life,
And if you don't have the Son, you don't have life, friends. All the religion in the world isn't going to make you to heaven. All the good works that you do. And I know people that are really, they are good people. Philanthropists who give millions, if billions. Oh, God, remember me. Well, do you know my Son? Did you remember him? That's the takeaway. Because there's some good people here. In fact, we're going to be getting a big stimulus pretty soon. And yeah, we'll take that, right? I mean, I don't want to get in that, but I mean, people say, yeah, sure, I'll take it. Well, God said, would you take my Son? Here's my stimulus package. Would you take him? And this package will never run dry if you keep looking to him daily, amen? It's up to you. And so Paul goes on and says this. He says, and I give you the sure mercies of David. He's talking about a prophecy in the Psalms. Therefore, he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. The corruption is like I said, that death where the body decays. Jesus rose the third day. For David, after he had served his generation by the will of God, fell asleep. In other words, he died and was buried. And he saw corruption. And David saw corruption. But he whom God raised from the dead saw no corruption. He raised it. There's no place that you can find Jesus' body. There's a lot of garbage out there today where people say, well, Jesus was buried over here. We have his bones. It's a bunch of hooey. It's a bunch of baloney. But people, they don't want to believe in Jesus, so they say that. And so it goes on and says, therefore, let it be known to you, brethren. He's still talking to Jews. He has that audience. He was invited in that synagogue like I was invited to that family. And he says to you, let it be known that through this man, Jesus, is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. Can you imagine people trying to pay? I mean, people that they do, they go to jail and they pay for their offenses through time and being away from family. But the Bible tells us that when Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You're forgiven, and yeah, you have everlasting life. And by him, everyone who believes is justified. By the way, friends, we believe. Some people say, well, you got to raise your hand, come to the front. That's all good. The Bible says, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But it's a long run where you're talking about Jesus to others. I kid John a lot. John, he's in the audience. And, you know, his testimony wasn't just when he raised his hand, but it's a continued testimony of acknowledging Jesus before others. He will one day say, John, enter into the joy of your Lord. Thou good and faithful servants, you confess me before men, I will confess you, John, before my Father. That's the truth, amen? And he'll do that for every one of us. But if we just say, well, I just have Jesus once, and that's all I need. Friends, it's the joy of being in the walk and life of Christ. That's where Jesus says, if you believe in me, out of you will flow. A flow is a continuum, right? Not like, oh, just like a faucet. Well, I got the faucet. I'm never going to open it up. You're not going to get any life coming out. But if you open your heart all the time and share this life, not being religious, it may sound like a religious run here, but it's not. It's a relationship. Just like we would share our grandkids or our kids with others. Hey, this is my son. This is my daughter. This is my grandkids. You're proud of them. We're proud of what Jesus done for us. And Paul goes on to say this. Beware lest what has been spoken in the prophets come upon you. Behold, that you despise this. You despisers, marvel and perish. So Paul's given a big warning from the Old Testament. He says, beware. And he's talking to us too. For I work a work in your days, a work in which you will by no means believe. See, we're here at the park and you are listening, you believe. But there's a lot of people that say, this is hooey. This is baloney. Well, for me and my house, Joshua said this, and he warned the people back then in Joshua 24. He said, for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. You don't have to. But know this, that one day there's going to be a reckoning. But Joshua, I have that saying in my home. Many of you may have that too. For me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Not religiously, not having to go to church, but we want to serve him because he's done so much for us and me. And so when this was done, Paul went on to say, so when the Jews went out of the synagogue, so the time where he had a chance to talk, he went out. And the Gentiles, listen to this, I like this part. They begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Can you imagine that? Hey, would you come back? You know, Jesse, would you come back and share that again next week? Paul, would you come back and share that? Lon, would you come back and share that? I'm going to bring family members. Would that be a trip? They wanted to hear more because the Spirit of God was moving through a man who once didn't believe and now he did. And they're asking him to come back. And so they begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. Now when the congregation had broken up, many of the Jews, devout proselytes. Proselyte is this. These were people that were Gentiles, became Jews. And they heard. And they followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. And Paul says, well, just continue. In other words, this isn't a one-time gig. This is a one-time deal. Man, it'll never end. And that's the beautiful thing that we have in Christ. It never ends. We have this place where God speaks to us. Jesus had a moment too. Jesus had a moment too where he went into a group, the synagogue, and he said these beautiful words in the Old Testament because he's on the scene. Here's Jesus on the scene, and he stands up. You've seen this in some of the movies where Jesus stands up and they give them the Torah, and they give him the prophets. And he picked this one part of the prophets of Isaiah, and he said this about the good news of salvation. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to open the prison doors of those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. I've always loved that part. The oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that they may be glorified. You know where it's talking a little earlier in the Old Testament, I believe it's in Isaiah as well, that one day when the Lord comes back, that you see, all of nature is held in a way where it does not have redemption. These trees come from a seed like us in that one sense, and they're born and they die. But with our seed and with consummation, there's a spirit that is inbred in humanity that is made in the image of God. But the trees, one day, and I don't understand this, but the Bible says this, they will clap. They'll speak to us. They'll talk to us. You imagine in heaven, we're walking around a beautiful park like this, and all of a sudden the trees start talking. They will. The Bible tells us that they'll talk, but they'll be clapping. I think clapping because the glory of the Lord is free to express itself without sin and without death and decay. Does that make sense? See, the Bible tells us that, but we don't talk a lot about it because we're too busy. We don't read the word like God wants us to. But Paul had the message, and it was centered on Jesus as he talked to the brethren at that synagogue. He was so desirous. He wanted to be consistent, sharing Jesus. It doesn't change. By the way, friends, the message doesn't change. It's consistent. The Old Testament, it points to him. From the very beginning, at Genesis chapter 3, when man fell, we call it the fall, when Adam and Eve, they fell. Actually, Eve's name wasn't even, it was the Adam and his wife. She wasn't, Eve, the name didn't even come up yet. But the Bible says in Genesis 3:15 that when they fell, God right away said, I'm going to crush you, Satan. He basically said that I'm going to bring one. He was talking right to Lucifer. When Jesus said, it's finished, Satan at that point knew he was done. When Jesus said, it's finished on the cross, yeah, Satan was finished. He was done because through that very act of God's love on the cross, all of creation is going to be changed. And you, when you receive him, you begin to change. You begin to learn of him. But there again, the people of Jerusalem at that time, as Paul is saying, they didn't recognize Jesus. They had the word and their heart was closed. Why was it closed? Because their heart was hard. You know, one day Israel is going to recognize Jesus. I love reading the Old Testament. I go through it every year, old and new. But one of the most fascinating books of the Old Testament is the book of Zechariah. How many have read the book of Zechariah? It's one of the most beautiful. I just encourage you, read the Old Testament. But in that book, there's a passage where Israel begins to, well, friends, there's going to be a lot of heartache in the future for the world, but especially Israel. They don't see Jesus as a whole yet, but there are Messianic Jews, such as Phil, part of our fellowship. He received Jesus, and he sees him as he is. Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus, Messiah. Zechariah 12, 10 through 11 says this, "And I will pour on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication. Then they will look on me." Who are they going to look on? They're going to look on Jesus. He's going to come back because the world is good. There's a spirit in this world that do not like Jews. Do you understand that? They don't like Israel to this day. And why? It's a spirit that wants to crush this nation, because through that very nation came Messiah, Jesus. And we got the Word of God, and Satan wants to crush this nation because he knows that his time is short. And so Israel as a whole don't see him, but the Bible says this, "They will look on me, Jesus, whom they have pierced." This is like 400 or 500 years before Jesus comes. The Holy Spirit is speaking of history as he acts, as he tells the story of what's to be. And he says this, "Yes, they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son." Can you imagine if you're an only son and that son were to die? How broken that person, that family would be over one son. But that's how deep Israel's going to say, "How do we miss you?" They're going to mourn when Jesus comes and he shows his hands like he did to Thomas. "Thomas, believe. Put your hands in my wounds. Put your hand in my side." And he says, he didn't do it. He instantly believed and said, "My Lord and my God." And Israel is going to do that one day. And they're going to mourn. "How do we miss you, Lord?" And, you know, there's other places the Bible says, "Don't worry." He says, he's going to basically say, "Don't worry, my love. You missed it, but I love you." That's how God deals with this. And they're going to grieve for him as one grieves for a firstborn. But Israel at that time, when Paul's talking to the synagogue, they didn't see him. And they, even though at that time, the Bible shows us that as we saw, that they can't see him. For some reason, I don't understand. The Bible says there's a veil of unbelief. And it's a veil over all people. And that's why God uses you and me to share Jesus. You say, "Well, I don't know. I heard Pastor's testimony when he was 21 and he wasn't ready." Friends, I did the best that I could, and God's going to use that too. I don't know how those people took that testimony of mine, but I shared what I knew, what he'd done for me. And that's what God's asking you too. You may not have gone to Bible college and all that, and even there, people don't want to know all your Bible stuff of what you've done. I mean, you can share truths, but do you care enough to say, "Jesus loves you and he cares for you"? People are going to listen to that. You know, also too, that Jesus, people don't see Jesus even today, but the Bible tells us in 1 John what's going to happen. In 1 John 13 through 11 through 13 says this, "Jesus came to his own, the Jewish people, and his own did not receive him." Can you imagine? Jesus is Jewish born. They've heard about, maybe, you know, in Bethlehem there might be a Messiah coming, but they missed it. Even at that time when he was born, Herod missed it, and all the other scholars missed it. They just, for some reason, they just missed it. People miss it. But the Bible says this, "But as many who receive him," Jesus, "to them he gave the right to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name." Jesus, what a sweet name. We sang this morning. That sweet name of Jesus. To use it every day, all the time. "Jesus, I love you. He's the lover of my soul, more than any human could ever give me. But out of that love from him, I can see a lot better my family, and others. Without Jesus, I become self-centered, and it's about me, myself, and I. And so it says this, and those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. In other words, the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God gives us that ability. And Hosea says this, what happens is with Israel as well as us, we're even as Christians, it's so important for us to read the word. We see in Hosea chapter 4, 6, it says this, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Friends, read the word. We are destroyed, even as Christians, because we don't know who we are in Christ. You're seated in heavenly places with the Father. You can ask Papa God anything in using Jesus' name. The Holy Spirit moves us that way, but the flesh is weak. It is weak. I'm weak too, but I need to take that time to seek him. It says, I will also reject you priests, to me. In other words, people think, well, I know Jesus, how about you? But they don't really put the time in. God is looking at a heart that's open to him. The hardness of the heart, you can't receive things from God. You may say you're a Christian, but if your heart is hard, and you're not forgiving people, friends, you may think you know a lot, but hardness of heart, not forgiving others who've hurt you, friends, you're just spinning your wheels. Know the scriptures. Open your heart. Be interested in things of God. God has a purpose. He wants you to know. Don't just slam your Bible down. I don't understand this. This is the pastor's job. I'm not going to read this. You need to go to school for this. Friends, it's all about Jesus. This whole book is about him. And if you read it with a hungry heart, I'm 19 years old and I'm a born-again Catholic. And it's like, I never read the Bible. We had this big old Bible on our table, and I mean, to choke a mule is so big. And when I found Jesus, when he found me, I don't help. Him found me, I found him. I was hungry, I needed help. I opened the Bible. King James. I read the King James a couple times, through and through. And I underlined. I save my Bibles when I get done with them because they're beat up. After about 3 or 4 years, you read them every day. They don't last. And so it turned out that I'm reading the Word. And Lord, I want to know you. Man, it was like seeing a puzzle. It's like, man, I see it. It's just like, it's there. I didn't have to call the pastor to show me. Would you teach me? Now, you'd get sermons every week. I'd go to church every week. And it's like, wow, I just read that. You know, there might be a sermon even here that they say, I just read about that. But you read it, and with a hungry heart, God starts to open your heart. And we begin to see that we're downloaded with that understanding that Jesus, what he did, he died for us, he rose for us. And those are crucial elements of the message that God's going to speak through you. He died for you, my friends. Man, he loved you. He rose from the dead for you. You see, those are the key elements that we need to understand. And knowing the scriptures, even the Psalms, it talks about Psalms 22. Well, we say, well, where's Jesus in the Bible? Psalms 22. They pierced my hands and my feet. And they came against me. And the Bible, the Holy Spirit speaking of Jesus, he's the historian. The Holy Spirit speaks through these writers, and they're talking about what's to come. Amen? The Holy Spirit is speaking through us. So we see that Jesus, he's that literal fulfillment of the scriptures. And Psalms, we just kind of read that, but I won't cover that. But in John 16, the Gospel of John 16, 13, 14 says this, however, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you. This is where we're talking about the Holy Spirit. He's the one who's behind the scene. When you speak, he's allowing you to share. Think, oh, I feel so alone. Friends, you're never alone. Jesus himself, by the Spirit of God, said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Is that an awesome feeling when you're in a dark place? God, what's going on? He'll guide you. But he says this in the gospel. Jesus is saying this. When he, the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit has come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority. That's why you say, well, how come the Holy Spirit doesn't speak? He's speaking through you. And sometimes the Spirit may speak to you in ways, just through your intuition. In other words, deep in your heart, your soul, deep in your gut, you just hear him. Go talk to this person. Or tell this person, you know, you're sorry. Get right. Whatever. And
he's not going to speak like I'm the Holy Spirit of his own authority, but whatever he hears, in other words, you, he will speak and he will tell of things to come. He will glorify Jesus, the Holy Spirit. You think, well, how come Jesus is speaking? He is speaking. See, the Holy Spirit, Father, Son, and Spirit, they're one. When God the Father speaks, they're all in agreement. It's kind of like a marriage. It's like, I don't go very far in trying to do things on my own without my wife's permission. And likewise, she always wins, but I try to win sometimes. But we try to always stay in agreement. And so the Holy Spirit declares himself to us. And we've studied about prophecy, and the prophecies points to Jesus. Point two, real quickly. Our message is justification by faith in Jesus Christ. It's all about forgiveness. Man, you know, we make mistakes. To feel forgiven, that's a beautiful place to be. And if we, in our faith, we bring that message across, God would have you, yeah, to turn away from where you're at and be forgiven. But people, and many times, they say, well, God can't forgive me. I mess up so bad. Friends, there's nothing God cannot do. All things are possible to those that believe. And friends, Jesus saves you and I. The scripture tells us that the help of the Holy Spirit, if we're to be open and humble, we'll listen, we'll hear. And so John 1, chapter 1, 3 through 6 tells us this. All things were made through Jesus, and without him nothing was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend. See, Jesus, he created us, but also what happened was that in the process, sin came, and in a lot of ways, he lost us. Sin, when we sin, God doesn't, he lets us make a decision, and we fall from this grace, but he made us to be aware of him and live with him throughout all eternity. Even these babies that are aborted, they just don't die. Their bodies die and they're put in a trash can or buried. Their soul and their spirit goes to heaven. They may not have all the download that you and I have through a lifetime of maybe 70 years, but their spirit and soul, there's these babies in heaven right now. And maybe some of us, even in the audience, before you came to the Lord, you've had abortions. Friends, you're going to see your babies in heaven. Maybe you had a miscarriage. You'll see those babies in heaven as well. Once there was consummation, there was a spirit, soul, and body. We were all there. And God has plans. But the enemy wants to say, as we grow, that God doesn't exist. And that's the fool that doesn't believe in God. And so we also see that because Jesus created us, he bought us. 1 Corinthians 6:20 says this, you were bought by a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which is God's. Ephesians says this, not only did Jesus, he came, he created us, he bought us, but he also married us. He's a God who says, I want to be so close, I want to marry you. See, that's what you hear at times, these pastors, and myself included, that I'm a bride of Christ. There's going to be a great wedding feast one day. He created us, he bought us, and then he marries us. The beauty of this kingdom. See, you say, well, you're a male. Listen, in the spiritual realm, when we get to heaven, there's not going to be marriage in heaven. The Bible, Jesus said that. But he has eternal plans forever and ever. I heard a little story, and it goes like this. A young boy worked hard to create a small sailboat. When the boat was painted and the sail set up, he carried it proudly to the edge of the river for its first launch. He placed it carefully in the water and slowly let out the string. The new boat sailed beautifully down the river. What a joy to see, the little boy thought. He sat at the edge admiring the little boat that he had built. Suddenly a strong current caught the boat. When he tried to pull it back, the string broke. Then the wind current pushed the boat downstream. The young boy ran along the shore as fast as he could, but within minutes the little boat was out of his sight. All afternoon he searched for it, but failed. When it was too dark to look any longer, he went home very sad. A few days later, on his way home from school, he spotted a boat just like his in the store window. When he got closer, he could see, sure enough, that's mine. He hurried into the store and spoke to the store owner, and he said, sir, that boat in your window, I made it. Sorry, son, but someone else brought it in this morning. If you want it, you'll have to buy it. He ran home and counted all his money, and he had exactly enough. He rushed back to the store to buy it. As he left the store, the boy hugged his handmade boat and said, "Little boat, now you're twice mine. First I made you, and now I bought you." You see, God's workmanship is for us. He bought us with his blood. He created us, and he shows us this great love of redemption that he has for us. The old scripture, from old to new, talks about Jesus' love. We see this in Isaiah 53, that he laid his life down for us, for our sins, and by his stripes we're healed. There's a freedom we have in Jesus. He forgives us. He comforts us. He's always wanting to be close to us in community and individually. But if we're passively about joining ourselves to Christ, or we can trust him with all of our life, then we can serve him. But don't be passive. See, there's a lot of Christians that are passive. "Well, I come to church. I feel good." We all feel good we come, or we read our Bibles. But don't be passive. Passive is like, "Oh, no big deal." Serve the Lord with a hunger and a thirst to know him. And join yourself in the fellowship. You at home there viewing, when this COVID's over, get in fellowship. Stay in fellowship. And stay in fellowship with the Holy Spirit by reading the Word. Serve the Lord and share the Lord through your life. You may one day get invited to somebody's home and you hardly know them, and you go in there. Be prepared. But share your life and do the best that you can. Paul had that opportunity, and they begged him. Man, the Holy Spirit began to speak to these people. "Tell us more about Jesus." And friends, the days are coming when they're going to be asking more about him, because they're going to see things that aren't going to go well in this world. It just doesn't look good. I'm sorry, friends. You may get a big stimulus. It ain't going to last. But the joy of God's love in your life will last forever. Amen. And I want to just, you have those points. Your faith needs to be your own. You can't be, you say, "Well, I like pastor's testimony. I only know mine." You have your own. You need to have your own voice. It needs to be able to stand alone. "Well, pastor, I just can't do that. I need you." No. I'll be with you. But you know what? I don't like that. You have your own voice. You can stand, because a great one is in you. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And also, you've been forgiven. I have. You're justified. Amen. And continue in this grace. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and your love. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do in our lives. I pray, Lord, that those that are listening live stream, and maybe later on YouTube, and those in the park, Lord, that we have an opportunity, Lord, to share this grace and goodness in our life and through our life. Lord, I pray blessings on those that are listening, those that are here in the park. Help us, Lord, to just know that you will never leave us nor forsake us. No matter what is today or tomorrow or forever, Lord, you're the same yesterday, today, now, and forever. And so we thank you, Lord, for this day. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone will say amen. God bless you. By the way, real quickly before we sign off, if you that are going live stream, we have a website, New Hope Fellowship, sandemus.org. If you want to support the church, you can go on our website and click in there and donate if you'd like to. God bless you. Thank you. We'll see you next week.